Hello, welcome back to History of Wine and the Vine. I'm Emily Kate. So the past few weeks, we've been doing a lecture series that encompasses us looking at wine in art throughout antiquity. And so far, we've been looking at antique Greek vase paintings, and we've been looking at the ancient Egyptian tomb paintings. So this week we're going to move on to sculpture and we're going to bring ourselves over to ancient Rome. Now, when we're looking at art and trying to kind of glean some historic understanding from it, it's important to consider a few things. It's important to think about who was commissioning this art, where the art was placed and for whom it was meant to be viewed by. We're looking at kind of the symbols that were used and different motifs, and then how popular the images were. So through these questions that we might ask ourselves when looking at each of these images, we can begin to understand more about the culture and the respect for wine drinking culture that was fostered in Rome. So first we have this one, and I'll let you know which museums these are all currently at if you'd like to go and look at them. So this is at the British Museum, and we're starting here with a marble statuette of Bacchus, and this is from the late Roman period. So as you can see, he's standing contrapposto, which means that most of his weight is on one leg, and as you can see, his left leg is kind of popped out, as we would say. In his hands, he's holding in his right hand a cantharos, and that's a cup or a jug for drinking wine. And in his left hand, he has a cluster of grapes. Now, this is the clearest depiction of Bacchus, because these are things that he is always holding. And if you are trying to identify a particular god or mythological creature in art, if he's holding grapes and a cantharos, he's most likely Bacchus or Dionysus. Now, other important things, over here, as you can see to the left, to our left and to his right, is an animal, and this animal is actually a panther. Now, a panther was incredibly important in identifying Bacchus and Dionysus because it was an image that was very commonly associated with the wine god. And I've read a few things on why, because I don't know if to anybody else this seems a bit random, but apparently panthers quite liked grapes, and that's kind of the best explanation that I've gotten for that one that I've read so far. So as we're looking, we also can look at how he's standing. We talked about the contrapposto, but really he's actually leaning. He's leaning on a trunk over here, and the trunk is actually being climbed up by ivy. So ivy is surprisingly not vine leaves, but ivy leaves were very associated with Bacchus and Dionysus. And as he's kind of leaning on this tree, we get in a feeling that he's not balanced. He's not necessarily in control of his own body. And that's very important. And you can also see that manifested in the fact that he's a little bit out of shape. And this is quite rare in terms of when you're depicting a god and you want to depict them in the most powerful, controlled way possible. I actually have a comparative image here for you. So obviously everybody knows on the left is the David. And on the right, this is an image actually from the Vatican, and this is Bacchus. And as you can see, even on these two comparative images, that Bacchus is just a little bit softer, we'll say. And as you can see, much like we spoke about in the first statuette, in this statue, he's holding a grape cluster in his left hand, and in his right hand, he's holding a drinking cup. So he seems to be deep in thought here, which is also a common way of depicting him. We'll just go back to the first one for a minute. So clearly, as you can see, this is kind of one of the most classic ways of depicting Bacchus. So as we move forward, here we have, this is actually at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. And this is a marble sarcophagus, and it's depicting the triumph of Dionysus and the four seasons. This is from the late Imperial Roman period, so circa 260 to 270 AD. And I'll point right here in the middle because this one has a lot going on. This right here, this is Dionysus or Bacchus and his trusty panther. So he's actually sitting on a panther, which is very, very important, again, in identifying him And then we have the Four Seasons. So this is a very high relief sarcophagus. So we can see here we have winter, spring, summer, and fall. And all these other creatures that you see surrounding Bacchus and the Four Seasons, they're actually Bacchic figures. So they're figures that have something to do with wine or grapes or wine culture. And so if you look over here, there's a little image and he kind of has, right here, and he kind of has this basket that was used for picking grapes. Over here, see if I can get that. Over here, there's kind of an image of a very small creature that's tending to a vine. So this is a really interesting and very full image here. And what I love best about this is actually, so we talked in the beginning about how it's important to think about who is commissioning the art and how popular it was. And this has a great story that goes along with it. So obviously this is a very high relief, very indulgently sculpted sarcophagus, and this would have been so expensive that only the true elite could have afforded to have this. So probably one of the old aristocratic Roman families would have commissioned this to be made. But they didn't necessarily commission it and decide what was going to be on it. It appears that this actually came from a sculptor's pattern book. And so how do we know this? Well, we don't have the pattern book, but what we do have is almost the exact same sarcophagus that turned up in Kassel, Germany. And what's great about this is that, so they're made in slightly different styles. So this one is higher relief, which kind of means, you know, the shadows that you see are a little bit darker because there's just more that's been taken away here. And what's great about this is that this means that this was part of a pattern. So this was a widely circulated pattern that people were interested in having carved. And actually what I love as well is that it's been speculated that this would have actually been colored. So colored or gilded. And as you can imagine, that would make it quite impressive to look at. And I think it's great because a lot of people, when we think about the ancient art, we think about this stark kind of ivory color. And what's great is that probably wasn't how these images were actually seen back when they were created. And a wonderful example is that they've actually taken the Parthenon and postulated that this would have probably been colored like you see here. And whereas we see this kind of stark image normally in our minds, they would have been looking at something that might have been more similar to this. So that's just a wonderful thing to think about if you can imagine this colored and gilded and just how decadent it would have been. So next, this is also at the Met in New York City, the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And these are, this is a marble round altar with a frieze of animals and masks. So what I love about this and why I love to include this is that this is not Bacchus. But we can, because the symbols that were associated with Bacchus were so strongly associated, we can actually postulate that this would have been likely used in a sanctuary of Bacchus. So the elements that we're looking at here, kind of the motifs, were commonly used with imagery of Bacchus. So we have theatrical masks, and then we have the panther. And again, this is so important to recognize that the panther was very, very closely tied to the wine god. And so, although we might think nowadays of a grape cluster or the cup, like a lot of them were, the panther was actually just as closely associated with the wine god. And just so that you know, this was from the Roman imperial period, and it was around the 1st century AD. So up last, here we have a great image. And this is actually a bust, a head of a statue of the god Dionysus. So Bacchus, Dionysus, again, Bacchus is the Roman counterpart to the Greek god Dionysus. And this was found at Hadrian's villa at Tivoli. So around the 2nd century AD, for those who aren't aware, Hadrian was the emperor of Rome. And this would have been an imitation of some bronze works that were made in Greece around the 5th century BC, so 3 centuries prior. And it was created for display, specifically at Hadrian's Villa. So Hadrian's Villa, it was located outside Rome. It was located in Tivoli, and it was enormous. He had 120 hectares, and he filled it with buildings, and then he filled those buildings with art. Now, what's important to think about when we're thinking about who was kind of commissioning these works? Okay, so we have Hadrian. Now, how popular were they, and who was meant to be looking at them? So Hadrian's Villa was a type of resort for the wealthiest and most elite members of Roman society. And the images that he chose to include, the kind of themes that he chose to include, were all reflective of the highest class's interests and their tastes and the culture that they were embracing. And it really gives us an idea about kind of the religious and cultural world at the time in Greece. So these Bacchus and Dionysus images were so important, and they were included very, very much so. There was many, many images of Bacchus and Dionysus that were included, which lead us to believe about how the ancient Romans embraced the drinking culture and respected the drinking culture. And so it's very interesting, all of the information that you can kind of glean from these images, but also from their context, from where they were, from who was kind of commissioning them, and who was meant to be looking at them. So I hope that this was a fun kind of lesson in art, and I hope that you learned a bit about wine and art and culture in ancient Rome, and I will see you next week. Cheers!